friends, can you all hear me? Am I audible to everybody?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah. Very, very good evening to everyone, and welcome to Centrum Connect. And we have with you, with all of us, Mr. Muralidhar M. So welcome, sir. And we will be starting shortly. So we're just waiting for all other students and parents to join in so that we can start.
Sure, Tushar.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Possibly I can start sharing my screen.
Yes. So I have made you the co-host. You can start. Yes.
Okay.
So before that, I'll just introduce Mr. Muralidhar M to everybody. So thanks to sir that you have spared some time for our children. And you are going to talk about aerospace engineering today. That is the theme for the session today. So a brief introduction about sir. He happens to be the parent of one of our students who studies in NPS Rajaji Nagar. And sir is working as senior engineering manager, and he is with Honeywell right now, and he is systems engineering, aerospace mechanical systems in that division particularly. So he is into systems engineering, and he is alumnus of BITS Pilani, Birla Institute of Technology and Sciences. So today, sir will be taking us through the specific field that is aerospace engineering. Lots of students have this query about taking up aerospace engineering either in the undergrad level or in the postgrad level, and after the exams they face, that is all these IIT JEE advanced and mains, when they go for counseling. So this is a common question, whether we should be taking up aerospace at undergrad level or should we be doing it later on. So with all those queries and the questions which you'd be having, the students community is having, so the structure is this. So sir is going to present his thoughts and views about his field, that is aerospace engineering, the work he's doing, and what a student who's aspiring to become an aerospace engineer can expect. And then towards the end, that is the last 30 minutes, we will be having an open session where questions from the students can be taken. So that will be the structure. With those words, I welcome again, sir. And now you can take it further up from here. Yeah. Thanks, sir.
Thanks, Tushar. I'm really excited to talk about aerospace engineering to the next generation of engineers and doctors in this call today. This session is going to be an interactive session and a very interesting session. So please participate and ask questions. And we don't want to make it a single monotone kind of a presentation. I would like to have a two-way communication. So Tushar knows about what is the content today. We have a lot of exciting content for you packed today. It's not a dull or a dry subject what we are talking today. So it will be an interesting 1.5 hour. And I wish you all you all have a good time for the next 1.5 hours. And as we talk in the next 1.5 hours, lot of interactions, more than I understanding, telling about my information to you, I'll also learn a lot from you. So I'm really excited today to address the student community of Centrum Academy. And thanks to Tushar for giving me the opportunity to share my perspective on aerospace engineering to the students. Tushar, I'll get started. Can anyone confirm that you are able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. We are able to see that. Yeah.
So I'll go to the full screen mode. So just give me a minute. And I just start my pointer also.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, it is.
So you can see my pointer.
Yes, sir. Yes, okay. It's in full screen mode now. Yeah.
And my PowerPoint charts are not blocked by anything like.
No, nothing. It's perfect. Yeah.
Oh, okay, perfect. So thanks again. So let's start with the topic of aerospace engineering. Aerospace engineering is one of those niche fields and a very exciting field. Sorry, somebody add something. Okay. One of those niche areas, and what we are going to talk today is basically to give you a perspective of this engineering discipline, and what are the things that are the opportunities that are available in this area is what we will talk about. So before we kind of get started, I want to make it a bit interactive. So you see the three pictures here, right? Can anyone identify what is this? What is the name of this aircraft?
You can put the answer in the chat box, friends. So those who know what all these figures are, you can just put it in the chat box.
So I'm just looking at the chat box. Wow, I think people have identified as a A350 aircraft. This is one of the, okay, that was good. Somebody says that it was there on the slide. That's a smart answer. So A350 is one of the modern jetliners that was developed a couple of years ago. And in the next 10 to 20 years, this will be the most widely used jet. So a lot of technological advantages in this. I don't want to get into deep. Just wanted to keep you just get to know what all we are talking about. So the next, I'm pointing the pointer there. This is a hard one. Can you tell me what is that? It's a rocket. I know that.
So someone is saying.
I will give you a small clue. Have you heard of? Somebody said it.
Yes. Somebody said.
SpaceX reusable. Oh, that's wonderful. Really. It's really great. We have a lot of Tushar. We have a.
I told you, sir. We will be having lots of people who are already, you know, well versed with.
So, somebody told about told that the SpaceX launch vehicle, reusable launch vehicle. The beauty about that particular vehicle is this was the first. Historically, all the rocket technology used to be with the governments. Or the companies, the research institutes like NASA, European Space Agency. But Elon Musk, as a single private individual, basically created a rocket industry. The main motive about Elon Musk's SpaceX program was to basically build low-cost reusable launch vehicles. You would have heard about interplanetary missions and space tourism and all these things, right? So having a low-cost vehicle and reusable vehicle is a key technology in that way. So in that way, this particular rocket system is a first step in that direction. Okay. Now the tough one. Can anybody tell what is the last one?
Private jet.
it's a private jet. I understand. It's a tough thing. I don't expect you to answer. Okay. Let me not delay because we have a lot of content to cover. That's electric aircraft. It is something called as urban air mobility vehicle. We'll talk about this. So these vehicles are not still there. It's currently under development. So basically, I will let the cat out of the bag. Imagine if you are able to travel from one part of the Bangalore, avoiding the traffic congestion. Okay. So is that possible? Certainly. So in today's world, it is possible. And this type of vehicle, which is electrical aircraft, which is usually called as a urban air mobility device aircraft. This is what it is. This particular picture, what I put, is from a company called as Eviation. So they are developing a electric aircraft. So it has just as you have heard about electric cars and stuff like that, right? So even in aviation, we are moving into the world of electrification. So with that context, I think we are well geared for. Taking the topic, so let me minimize the chat window here. It's a bit distracting. Okay.
Is it stuck? So you can just shift it on the right or left, maybe.
No problem. Yeah. No problem. Okay. So I didn't want to jump in to say, oh, this is aerospace engineering, and you will learn these things. These are the institutes. That's not the point here, right? So the point here is, I wanted to give you some inspirational events that happened over the history. In the history of aviation. The reason why I'm talking about this is it will give you an overall context about where we are today in the world. Okay. The first thing is what we call it as a Da Vinci's helicopter concept. So Da Vinci, as early as 15th century, basically sketched in his book a concept of a helicopter, which was powered by humans. So what he had envisaged is there is a shaft here, and there are couple of humans. Those days it would be slaves possibly, because they were the easiest available people to do that. So by turning the shaft, this device used to go up and down. We never know whether Da Vinci built that or not, but Da Vinci had maintained a very meticulous diary with him, where he had all his concepts, ideas sketched very well. So this is the earliest instance of an air vehicle that we see in history. Okay. Now fast forward two centuries later. In early 1783, in the city of Paris, there was a wealthy merchant, paper merchant. Somebody had a question?
No.
There was a wealthy paper merchant by name Montgolfier. So he had a passion for flight. So what he did was, he observed that, because he was a paper merchant, he was able to build paper lanterns, just like the lanterns what we see in our Diwali. So he saw the paper lanterns going up. So I thought, instead of building a small lantern, how can I make a big balloon kind of thing so that I can use the same mechanism and fly the thing? So those days, it was a very novel thing. The only things that that could fly were birds, and the people used to look at owl with the birds saying that, oh, how can a man can fly? So this individual basically built a big balloon. And they had two people fly for 25 minutes over the city of Paris. So this was one of the first instances where humans became airborne. So that's a very significant event in the history of the humankind. Okay. Now again, let's go to the picture three. Do you know rocketry technology originated in India? This was first deployed in the state of Mysore. It was called as Mysorean rockets. Tipu Sultan, during the Anglo-Mysore wars, he developed this device. If you see here, you can see the picture here, right? So this is a kind of a rocket wherein he used to kind of attach the sharp devices like sword or something, and he used it extensively against the British during the Anglo-Mysore wars. Sad part was Tipu Sultan lost the war. And all this rocket technology, more than rocket technology, the rockets were all confiscated by the invading British forces, and they took back to Britain. And that's where the rocketry was born in Britain. And finally, as all of you know, right, it from Britain, it spread to Americas and all over the world. And you know who put the first person on the moon, right? So basically, we all should be, we as Indians, we should have been, and moreover, we as people living in the state of Karnataka, and this particular Mysorean rockets originated in our state. So rocketry technology basically originated in our place. And if you are familiar with the Bangalore area, the place around the city market, what we call it as today city market, that is where Tipu Sultan had his, what you call in our words, as a research and development for this Mysorean rockets. That place, even today, if you go, it's called as Paramandal Pet. So it's like a small place of galaxy. So he had his most knowledgeable people in the kingdom. Basically, they built this rockets, and he built that rockets and used it against the British for the war purpose. So let's fast forward from the 17th century. We'll come to the 19th century. So people are always thinking, how can we make a powered flight? We learned about balloons. Balloons is not really a flight in a real sense, right? Because balloon is a lighter than air flight. So basically, if you put a gas inside a balloon, which is lighter than air, it just goes up, right? But an aircraft is something that is heavier than air, right? If you see a aircraft today, it is a solid metal object, right? How can you make it that fly? So a lot of engineers, scientists took this challenge to build the heavier than air flight, but none of the people were successful. It had the two ingenious, not very well read brothers, the Wright brothers, Oliver and Wilbur Wright, through their sheer ingenuity, they were not well educated people. They owned a small bicycle repair business. They built the first heavier than air aircraft, and on December 17th, 1903, this aircraft flew for 60 seconds. And from that day, I think it opened the dawn of air travel and the world of aerospace engineering. So it's such an important thing, the first flight of Wright brothers. That's one of the reasons why I kind of put this in this chart. Now, another 80 years, we were built aircrafts flying all around that. But people were always thinking, okay, if I fire a rocket into space, the rocket goes and that's it. I mean, it doesn't come back, right? So can we build a device so that, like an airplane, it goes into the space and comes back successfully? So we can do a lot of reusable missions going up and down. So in year 1981, NASA built the space shuttle, and space shuttle revolutionized the space missions, because the fleet of space shuttles, what NASA used to have, they used to make regular flight from Earth to the outer space and back. So that basically brought in the world of reusable flight across space. Okay. So the last thing, I talked about Elon Musk. It is the thing on February 18th, Elon Musk, this is more of a novelty. What he did was Elon Musk has a space company, which is called as SpaceX. He has a automotive company called as Tesla. Yeah, we can think this as a marketing gimmick, or we can think of this as a stroke of genius. Either way, whichever camp you are in, right? Whether if you admire Elon Musk, you will say it's a stroke of a genius. So what Elon Musk did is he used his rockets from his own company, SpaceX. And this car, this is a Tesla Roadster. It's an electric vehicle, what was manufactured by Tesla, which he used to use this car to commute to work. He basically put this car in his own spacecraft and he launched in space. So as we talk today, this particular car is orbiting the sun, but it is very far away from Earth. So it is not going to come and strike our Earth as of now. So, just a quick question here. There's a mannequin here, right? Does anybody know what is the name of that mannequin? Anybody heard? I just see the chat window. Yeah, Pawan says it's a Starman. It's a wonderful thing. Tesla named this mannequin as a Starman. So his point of view is down the light years or centuries going forward from now, some intelligent life from the other planet or other galaxy comes and sees, and they see the spirit of human ingenuity. So that was his ask, or his motivation beyond putting this Tesla Roadster in space. So I think all of us have enough motivation right now to kind of get started with the actual talk. So let's go to the next chart. So we talked about inspiring technologies, right? What happened in aerospace. Let's talk about some great personalities who were all aerospace engineers. I don't have to introduce all the great people who are there on the chat. Our former president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, graduated from aerospace engineering from Madras Institute of Engineering. He was one of those early students of Madras Institute of Technology who graduated in aerospace. He was popularly called as the missile man of India, who built the entire missile defense capability of India, and ultimately rose to occupy the highest seat in our country as a president of India. You might know Kalpana Chawla, right? Kalpana Chawla was the first woman of Indian origin to go to space. She graduated as an aerospace engineer from Punjab Engineering College. And afterwards, of course, she did her higher education in the US. Neil Armstrong was also an aerospace engineer by training from Purdue. And Neil Armstrong was the first person to walk in the moon, right? So last but not least, I've spoken much about Elon Musk. Elon Musk basically founded the SpaceX organization, which was the first privately owned company that built rockets. And he has a grand vision to kind of develop reusable rockets that will enable people to travel to space and come back as tourists. So let's see how the things shape up in the years to come. So I talked about the inspiration. I talked about the the great people who were aerospace engineers. So I just wanted to kind of pitch here why aerospace is a very very good area or a very interesting area to work, and why should students or people who are at a stage where they're deciding which career they want to pursue, why they should consider aerospace. So first of all, aerospace is a very high technology area, right? So when an industry is high technology area, it is always attracting the best minds in it. So you will be able to work on one of the most challenging projects and most path-breaking projects as part of the aerospace engineering. And aerospace engineering is basically a hotbed of innovation. As I told you, right, I talked about the reusable rockets, I talked about the urban air mobility, the flying cars. So all these things are hotbed of innovation. So if somebody who is very curious, who wants to contribute, so this is an area to really get into. And as all of you know, aerospace engineering is basically an indication of the technology prowess of any country. So as you know, all countries in the world cannot build rockets, right? There are only a handful of countries who can build rockets. Incidentally, we as Indians, we are proud that we are able to, we have a capability to build rockets to take our satellites to space. And we did missions to Mars, Moon. So every country in the world doesn't have that capability. So basically, the aerospace technology is the pride of the country. So on the pointer where I'm pointing, you see the LCA Tejas, right? LCA Tejas is the fighter aircraft that was developed by engineers in our own country. So again, when we talk about building a jet aircraft, a fighter jet aircraft, not every country in the world has a capability to build the aircraft. They have to buy from somebody else. Only, I would say, like handful of countries, few European countries, America, and in Asia, it is Japan, China, and India who can do that. So all these things are basically the pride of the country, and there is a lot of technology that is associated with that. So these are all the points what I thought I will talk about. And another important point why you should consider the aerospace engineering is air travel has become very, there has been explosive growth of air travel in the last couple of years. 20 years ago, flying in air from say Bangalore to Delhi or Bangalore to Mumbai used to be a novelty, right? Now even small cities in Karnataka are linked by air travel. So that means a lot of airplanes are going to get inducted into service in the next couple of years. So that will open up various opportunities for the engineers who kind of take the aerospace engineering as a subject to study. And needless to say, there is a lot of new areas coming up. As I talked about the urban air mobility, I have a special set of charts later in the presentation where I show how urban air mobility vehicles, the electric vehicles, will revolutionize the transportation, what we see today. So just keep yourself patient until that. I will come back there and we will have a lot of discussion on that. So any questions on this before I move on to the next chat?
So there is a question from Prakul, and he's asking about the difference between aerospace and aeronautical engineering. So I think someone has already answered this. Yes. So yeah.
Yes, aeronautical includes. I mean, it's kind of
subset. Really,
there is no. I mean, the difference is there, but. Aerospace includes both the machines that is flying within the earth and also outside the earth, right?
Yes.
So that way, I think, but most of our, I think in India, we use these terms aeronautical and aerospace engineering interchangeably. So basically, it's the same thing, at least in India, what we do. So somebody had a question, what is the difference between ISRO and DRDO? ISRO is the agency that is entrusted by the government of India to develop space technology and basically rocketry. So this is Indian Space Research Organization. DRDO is the organization which the government of India has set up to develop technologies specifically for the defense system. And they have a whole lot of technologies they develop. They have a lot of labs across the country. And some of the labs are specifically focused to aviation. Like, for example, you have the gas turbine research establishment. So they build gas turbine engines. You would have heard about ADE.
It's here. It's in sir, old airport. Yeah, near old.
They make drones. They make all the. Yeah, so it's basically the umbrella organization for all the defense labs here in India. Yeah. So more. One more question.
Can every aerospace engineer go to space?
I mean, anybody can go to space. Actually, you need to have that. In fact, if you see the if you read the profiles of people who used to go on space shuttle, now there is space shuttle has been grounded, right? It's not used. They used to have all type of people going on space. There used to be doctors because people go to space to do some studies, right? So there used to be physicists, there used to be aerospace engineers. So
in fact, Rakesh Sharma, the first. Astronaut from India was not an engineer. I think he was a Air Force.
Rakesh Sharma was a pilot.
He was a pilot. So hence, you don't need to be an aerospace engineer, so to say, to go to space. But you must have that training for requisite training.
You should also have your physiology also capable for that. So before somebody becomes astronaut, they are put to a very rigorous training wherein their body physiology has to support them, right?
Yeah.
And also, space travel is not a easy thing, right? There is long, there is extreme radiation, there is extreme changes in from gravity to no gravity. So they select the people based on the fitness level, their mental composition.
Stability.
It's a multiple thing. It's a multidimensional. So people actually apply for going to space, but they are evaluated on various parameters and they basically select the people who are most suitable for that. So that's one of the reasons, it's there. So there is one more question I see. What was the reason for banning space shuttles? It's not banning space shuttles. Space shuttles were built in early 80s and there were a couple of accidents.
Kalpana Chawla actually.
Kalpana Chawla was a crew of the Columbia space shuttle.
2002, I think this was the year.
And NASA was trying to fix all the issues with the space shuttle, but they got to a point saying that today we should not be sending people to outer space with the space shuttle because we see a lot of issues with the thing. So NASA is actually coming up with a reusable space vehicle. Mm-hmm. So right now, if somebody has to travel to the space, they only have to depend on the Russians.
Soyuz.
Soyuz is the only, if somebody has to go to the International Space Station, it's only Soyuz, which is the vehicle that is there. Earlier, there used to be Soyuz, there used to be Space Shuttle. Now it's only Russians who are able to take the people. But as you see, SpaceX is also coming up with reusable rockets. NASA is coming up. So it's in a couple of years, all these things will become. And today's technology is in such a way that we really don't want to send people to space until it's really required. We have robots that can go and do the work what humans can do. So let's move on. We'll take the questions later. Okay, so what are the areas of studies if you want to enter into the aerospace industry? So even general subjects like mechanical engineering, electronics engineering, computer science, metallurgy and materials, all these skills are widely used in aerospace industry. So anybody who has studied mechanical engineering or computer science can find opportunities to work in the aerospace industry. So it doesn't have to be an aerospace graduate to kind of work in the aerospace industry. Having said that, there are institutes offering courses that are in line with aerospace engineering. Like most of the, I'll talk about the institutes in the next chart. Most of the institutes like IITs, they have aerospace engineering department. So aerospace engineering at undergraduate level, they gave you BTech in aerospace engineering. So that's kind of, if you take aerospace engineering in IITs, it's a mix of both the mechanical and electronics engineering. So they study, some people for kind of take their studies more in the mechanical line, because aerospace aircraft has both electronic and mechanical components. Some people study with a more emphasis on electronics, which is basically the avionics. So it depends based on what type of electives that you choose as part of your study in the chosen institute. At the postgraduate level, there is a lot of specializations available. Avionics specializations is available in a lot of institutes in the country. Avionics is basically the electronics that is there embedded in the aircraft. So it's a vast field by itself. So there is a master's degree in avionics, again, offered by a lot of institutes, which I'll talk in the next chart. For people who are interested in space-related part of the aviation, there are courses at the master's level in Earth and Space Sciences. There is courses on space engineering and rocketry. And there is also some fundamental or classic post-graduation courses in aerospace, like aerodynamics and flight mechanics. So this is about mainly about how to design the aircrafts to make it more efficient and stuff like that. And there are also courses on propulsion and thermal. So these propulsion are basically the engines that that are there in this aircraft or rockets. So you specialize in basically in developing these devices. So let's move on to the next chart. I have listed here only the institutions that are available in India. Of course, we are not touching what institutes are there abroad. If anybody has a question, I can answer. But because I know a lot of our students are preparing for the JEE and the BITS and exam here in India, I just wanted to list the institutes that have aerospace engineering here in India. Almost all the IITs have a department of aerospace engineering. So IITs would be the first port of call if somebody wants to specialize in aerospace engineering. Indian Institute of Science also has the aerospace engineering department. But as you know, Indian Institute of Science don't have a bachelor's degree, right? It's only a master's degree. So it's only at a postgraduate level, they have aerospace engineering. A couple of years ago, an institution that was specifically created for space sciences and technology in Trivandrum. So this institute is called as Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology. So this, the focus of this institute is exclusively space space technology, but they do also have some courses that are related to aerospace and avionics. So that institute also, there is a, I think even this also is part of JEE, right, Tusha?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and some of the NITs also have departments of aerospace engineering. I have listed this IISER, Indian Institutes of Science Education and Research. They don't have a core aerospace application. Moreover, that's not an engineering course. It's a
science
integrated master MSc, master MS course. So if somebody wants to study on areas like fundamental research like aerodynamics or computational fluid dynamics, the mathematical
astrophysics is also
there. Or even like what Tushar says, somebody wants to study about astronomy, astrophysics. So these are institutes that have a lot of, and these institutes are really good because these are mainly, it's not an engineering institute, it's a science focused institute with lots of fundamental research. So I know I've seen students graduating out of these institutes, going to places like MIT and Stanford. So it's a very, very good.
Sir, if they want to join public sector undertakings or Government of India, you know, organization like ISRO and all, so they have direct recruitment from these colleges. Yeah.
So there are some old institutes when I say old, these are institutes that have been offering aerospace engineering from the 1950s and 60s. So one such institute is, of course, Madras Institute of Technology. So one of the oldest aerospace engineering faculties here in South India. Of course, in north of India, one of the oldest aerospace engineering institutes is in Punjab Engineering College. In fact, the alumni of these two colleges are why we saw in the inspiring people. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam graduated from MIT, Madras Institute of Technology, while Kalpana Chawla graduated from Punjab Engineering College. So these are one of the older institutes that have very strong aerospace engineering departments. Because of the growth in the aerospace area, initially a few years ago in Karnataka, in state of Karnataka, we never had, if you exclude ISC, we didn't have any BTEC or bachelor's degree in aerospace. But because we see a lot of opportunities, some of the reputed colleges in Bangalore also have aerospace departments. I know RVC has aerospace department, BMSC has aerospace department, even Manipal University has aerospace department, and some of the BTU affiliated colleges also have aerospace engineering departments. VIT University also has aerospace engineering department. The last thing, BIT Mesra, this is the Birla Institute of Technology Mesra, they also have a very old space engineering and rocketry department. These were one of the earliest rocket engineering departments that is there. So they are a very reputed institute with a lot of legacy. So these are some of the options that you have to basically study aerospace engineering in India. So should I look, any questions before I move on?
So there is a question related to nuclear and quantum physics.
What's the question, Tushar?
The question is, will they also venture into nuclear and quantum physics? So I think this question is for ISERS, right? Kinshuk, if I'm not
wrong. Yeah. So ISERS would have all this quantum and nuclear physics. Nuclear physics would be there. Nuclear engineering would not be ISERS. ISERS is all
sciences
oriented.
Yeah.
Nuclear engineering, I don't know whether, do we have nuclear engineering in
India?
I think IIT should have, right? No, we don't have.
No, sir. We don't have nuclear engineering as such. You know, there are different domains, maybe you know, related to that, but not as such. Mechanical engineering.
In abroad, we have nuclear engineering as a discipline, but in India, I have not heard. Probably, I don't know. I'm not data.
And if you want to go into the sciences side of nuclear nuclear science side of it, there is a very famous institute called Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics, SINP. So that's also one of the very famous institution. Dedicatedly for nuclear physics in India.
Yeah. Any other questions? I am just opening the chat box to.
So there was another question in terms. So are these listed in terms of decreasing order of quality? Nikhil, just
No. It has nothing to do with. I should have put that disclaimer.
There's no order here.
Order here. It is just a random list.
Yes. So hence, don't worry about, everywhere, any college you go, you will be able to, chart out a great career path. So that's not a problem. Then the next question is, should I take in ISC for undergrad to get into aerospace domain? Not needed, in my opinion.
Not needed.
Yeah.
Not needed. In fact, as I told in my previous chart, you don't have to take an aerospace domain to get into aerospace. Even if you're a computer science engineer, you could still, I'll talk about software, the role of software in aerospace engineering. If you are a mechanical engineer, you are an electronics engineer, you are a computer science engineer, you can always get into aerospace.
So, just to add here, most of, when we were into IITs, the concept was that, you can always move. So as the other slide, which sir showed, there was component of electronics, which goes into avionics. So there was computer science, as sir is saying, and then let's say mechanical engineering, structure engineering, all of that. Anyways, so if you are, let's say, doing an undergrad program in all of these courses, you can take it as a specialization of aerospace engineering in your master's program degree. Yeah. So that also is another option of because the other aspect of it is many people do not know or they are not very sure whether they want to do aerospace as such. So what they do is they take a neutral kind of engineering branch, which can lead you to all of these. So mechanical is like and these days for that matter, any branch, for example, material science, if you really see, during our time, and it has not changed after our time as well, when we were writing JEE, people do not pay attention to these, they think because ranks are lesser. So hence people of lesser rank go there, and some kind of useless class system is going on. So you do not think like that. Material science is such a, you know, one of the, what do you say, without material science, none of the engineering fields can exist.
Yeah.
So hence we have to have very open-minded towards the subject. You must be picking up depending upon what's your choice or like, you know, liking, rather than what rankings are pushing people to that particular. Just to add, I'll take a half a minute here. There's an engineering branch called Ocean Engineering and Naval Architecture, right? So it's a, you know, it's offered by IIT Madras, it's offered by IIT Kharagpur, and I was, you know, we were astonished to see such a specialized course. You will be designing ship, you know, and that is like rarest of the rare breed of engineers are there. So only when we go there, we understand that, hey, I'm now in mechanical engineering, which is like, you know, everyone is doing it. Instead of that, I could have done that. So please be open with all these, you know, so there is no ranking, no class system about any subject, so to say. And also try and explore as much as you can about all the courses, and hence this series. So this will definitely help you. Okay, so just to answer, you don't need an undergrad aerospace to be in aerospace. Yes, if you're already decided, it's always good to, you know, be in your specialized stream and then, you know, try to perfect that subject. That's it. Yeah.
Yeah, Tushar said it right. There is nothing like this subject is good, that subject is good. We have to strive for excellence in whatever field we choose, right? So that's the key thing. You could have the best degrees in the world, but if you're not motivated to do the job, you cannot be successful, right? It really doesn't matter where you studied. You have to bring innovation and creativity into your work every day, and bring a lot of value to the work what you did. That will take us further. Degrees are only one pillar of success in life, right? There are other pillars that are more important than the basic academic degree. So I would say that, and let's move on.
Yeah. So just one more query is there before we move. So it's a very simple.
Yeah, please.
Can aerospace be studied to get into mechanical field? They are very similar. Let me tell you, give you a background from IIT Kharagpur, lots of aerospace engineers had to take electives in mechanical, and lots of mechanical will have to take electives in aerospace, and vice versa. And you have to also take electives in multiple other departments. So today, as such, there is no limitation that if you end up taking undergrad in aerospace, it's nothing but a extended arm of mechanical engineering only. And yes, yeah. The added advantage is you also get to study electronics and other components on top of it. So hence, you can definitely get into a mechanic. Let's say if you want to specialize in thermodynamics after doing aerospace, you can do it.
Correct. As Tushar said, if you take any course in IITs, or if you go through what are all the course subjects they study, it would be depending on the IITs, it would be a tilt of 50% of mechanical or 50% of electronics. Or in some cases, it might be 60% of mechanical, 40% of electronics. Or it might be 80% of mechanical or 20%, or vice versa. It just depends upon how they kind of structured their curriculum. So, I mean, if you read through the syllabus and thing, you can say, oh, this is primarily mechanical oriented, this is primarily electronics oriented, because electronics and mechanical are the two engineering fields that are basically the building blocks of aerospace technology. Aerospace technology is how to apply mechanical engineering and electronics engineering to build vehicles that fly. So that's basically the concept. Any questions, Tushar? Should we move?
Sir, just I think they are now talking about what was your UG field.
And I studied mechanical engineering. I never had a degree in aerospace engineering, but my experience was I began my career in aerospace engineering.
Which clarifies all doubts that whatever stream you start, we have an aerospace engineering engineer sitting in front of us who did mechanical in his undergrad. So hence. Okay, if you can do it.
Yeah. So again, it's a vice versa also. If you see an industry, people who studied aerospace engineering, they might be working in automotive engineering, right?
Quite possible, in
companies they are doing. So again, as I said, right, our education is to give us a wisdom to solve the problems of the world. It has nothing to do with whether you solve problems of aircrafts or develop software or solve the problems of mobility of cars. So education should be viewed as as a wisdom that you gain, and how do you apply that wisdom is what is in your hands, right?
Yes, very well said, sir. Yeah.
Let's move on.
Yes, we can move on.
Okay, so I also wanted to list what are all the organizations that are primarily aerospace centric. So this would give us give you a picture of what are the opportunities aerospace engineers have. So on the left hand side, where my pointer is pointing, these are all large global companies that do work for aerospace. So some of the companies like Boeing, Airbus, Embraer, Gulfstream, they build the aircrafts. Got it. Right, they build the actual aircraft. But aircraft is not, the technology in aircraft is not just building the aircraft. There are systems in aircraft that is more a technology differentiator. So most of the systems are built by suppliers like Honeywell, Collins Aerospace, Moog, General Electric. General Electric, Rolls-Royce, and Pratt & Whitney, these are the companies that, the big three companies that build the aircraft engines, so the gas turbine engines. Companies like Honeywell, they also make aircraft engines, smaller aircraft engines, but they are big into all the mechanical systems of the aircraft, the air conditioning system, the auxiliary power system, the electronics system. And Honeywell is very big into the avionics systems, the cockpits, whatever you see in the aircraft, right? There's a lot of technology that is there in the cockpit. So Honeywell builds the cockpit technology. There are companies like Collins Aerospace, which does the same thing like Honeywell. They are a direct competitor to Honeywell. They make mechanical systems, they make electronic systems. But there are European companies like Safran, which is a French company, makes a lot of aircraft systems. There is the German company called Liebherr. Again, they also make a lot of aerospace systems. Japanese companies are Mitsubishi Aerospace Aircraft Corporation. They also build aircrafts. Russian company Irkut, they are also building a lot of commercial aircraft. China is also getting into big climate aviation. Comac is one of the company that China is building the commercial aircraft. And these are all the space companies. NASA, of course, all of you know, I don't have to tell. SpaceX, you know. Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman are companies that make, that primarily play in the military side of aviation. And even Dassault is a French company that does a lot of military aircrafts, and they also make civil aircrafts. So we have all the, I have not listed all the aerospace company, probably it'll have like 200 to 300 companies. I've listed all these companies because many of these companies have operations here in India. So people who graduate from aerospace engineering, they may get some opportunities as interns to work in these companies, or even opportunities to work in these companies. So these are all the foreign companies that are into big foreign companies that are there in aerospace. On the right hand side, these are companies in India who also do significant amount of work in aerospace engineering. So the Defense Research and Development DRDO labs, there are multiple labs of DRDO that are primarily focused to aerospace engineering. ISRO is primarily the space technology. It's a NASA of India. So they make all the space technology. HAL is the Indian aircraft manufacturer. They primarily make a lot of military aircrafts and helicopters. NAL is also a government organization, National Aerospace Laboratories, but their mandate is mainly to build civil aircrafts, not the military aircrafts. Indian Air Force is not the institution that build airplanes, but they have a large fleet of aircrafts in their inventory, be it military aircraft, be it civil aircraft. Yeah. So somebody who is aspiring to become a pilot and who doesn't want to spend so much of money on pilot training, the easiest and I would not say the easiest, the cost effective option would be Indian Air Force, but it will take years before you become the pilot. In fact, most of the pilots, they are former Indian Air Force pilots who after their retirement go into the civil world. So a lot of companies in India that do aerospace, these are private sector companies like TCS or Infosys or Cyient or HCL. They are not primarily aerospace companies, but they work for this kind of clients abroad. So they do also hire a lot of aerospace engineers as part of their workforce. Yeah. So that this I wanted to give you a perspective to look at what are the opportunities that is there for the aerospace engineering.
So one takeaway is, you know, even if you land up in, any of the IT, but, you know, giants in India, there will be projects which will be dealing in aerospace vertical categorically. Yeah. So hence, it's not that you have to be in an aerospace firm to, you know, express your talent or whatever you have learned. In India also, these kind of service companies are there, which you can be into, or there are a series of startups which are now coming. Anyway, sir will throw some light on that. So there are, you know, many of them are now, and, you know, earlier, what service anyways throws light on this part of the field is, earlier it was a domain of Government of India. So they had, full monopoly over the space, aviation and space, and slowly now they are, liberalizing it. So hence, there will be a lot of opportunities for you guys when you will be in the workforce to be a part of it. And you might have heard of that ISRO keeps on encouraging, I have heard of IIT students building satellites, small satellites,
nano satellites,
and they are sending it to space. So, yeah, sir.
So there are, adding to what Tushar said, there are a lot of startups within the country, more specifically in Bangalore, that work in this aviation and space area. They develop a lot of systems. They develop a lot of, I'll talk about that in upcoming slides. So yeah, I've not listed those names. And as in the next 10 to 20 years, a lot of these startups today might become big companies in the next 10 to 20 years. So basically what is happening is what used to be like a heavily government centric organization and primarily a US or a European based entities are now getting spread over all over the world because of the because the technology is now available to everybody, and it's a wish of each nation to kind of build the get into this space. So that's that kind of puts a context for what are all the opportunities that might come in years to come.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on. So I kind of put this chart so that you get to know what aerospace engineer does in his day job. So, I mean, I didn't want to confuse you by putting a lot of technical terms and talking through it and explaining through it. That's not the intention here. The intention here is to get a feel of once a person gets into industry, what he does. So a typical work anybody would do is, they would be developing systems. If you take an aircraft, right, there are a lot of subsystems in it, right? So each of these systems are very, very complicated by itself and they are independent by itself. So most of the jobs would be in developing these systems. This might be the hydraulic system of the aircraft, the air conditioning system of the aircraft, or developing the engine system, you name it. So each of these systems is basically done by a lot of companies, what I showed you in the prior chart. Software is a very, very important piece in aerospace industry. And this is one of the things that employs a lot of people in aerospace industry. In fact, almost 70% of engineers would be involved in some kind of developing of software because there is software in all the systems that is there on the airplane. And software, because aircraft being a safety critical equipment, there is a lot of activities that are tied in with software. So software is an integral part of aerospace, and the activities like verification, validation, software development, testing is a big part in the aerospace industry. So engineers who will be working in aerospace would be developing software of some type or another. And another job profile that would be there in aerospace industries, see, there are systems from different companies, right? So a company aircraft manufacturer has to bring all this system. So when we have to bring all the systems to talk to each other, in an engineering term, what we call it as systems engineering. So that's a big activity. So a lot of engineers do that work as part of the job. Flight testing would be another area wherein people, once any aircraft is built, there is extensive flight testing being done to basically test how the equipment that we have provided works well. So a lot of engineers would be working in this area wherein you will be solving the problems that are there in the field, making sure the equipment is working for the specification what is done. Needless to say, in any engineering field, the job of an engineer is to solve problems, right? Problem solving is a big thing. So same thing appears, same thing is there for aerospace engineering also. And needless to say, the last thing what I put, innovation is a key thing in this industry. It is not a very static industry. You have to get better than the next competitor. So finding better ways of doing things is what innovation is, right? So this is a key thing if you are part of the aerospace industry. You could take an aerospace engineering role and decide to take up a career in academia. When I say academia, it's a research-oriented field in universities, right? There are a lot of universities that are aviation-focused around the world. So a typical job profile would be, you will be performing research on some of the new technologies. Like I'll talk about some of the new technologies. So in academia, people basically focus on a narrow problem and they go into depth and they solve the problems. And once they develop the technology, they bring back that technology to be used by the industry. Industry is basically using the technology that is proven and available, and they are kind of integrating the technology. Think of technology as a Lego blocks, right? So you build a big Lego, but you don't worry about the small Lego block, right? So assembling the Lego blocks, build a bigger. So in industry, we use different technologies, but we don't develop technologies. We use a technology that is readily available and integrated. So let's move on to the next chart. So I also wanted to use this opportunity to talk about some of the futuristic areas. People who select the career in aerospace in now and once that they come out of their universities, what are the typical areas that they would work, which people are not working today? Electrification is a big thing all over the world. As you see, in the next couple of years, we will see a lot of electric cars in the roads, right? So same thing applies to aviation also. There are a lot of electric aircrafts, small electric aircrafts will come into the picture. So all the technologies that is related to electric, basically the motor design, the software that kind of drives that, all the things will be a big thing in years to come. Air taxis will become very ubiquitous in years to come. I have a nice presentation coming up, so please hold on if you have any questions on that. Hydrogen powered aircraft will be a big area in the next couple of years. The reason is current aircrafts are powered by jet fuel, which is a type of a kerosene. So because of high altitude flight, the emissions are a problem to the atmosphere and to the earth, right? So a lot of research is going on to make aviation green, basically eco-friendly. So hydrogen powered aircraft is one of the bigger areas that we will see traction in years to come. Supersonic travel will become a reality. This is not something new. People have heard about Concorde. Concorde was the first supersonic aircraft, but it was quite ahead of its time. Concorde was decommissioned a couple of years ago because of, again, safety issues. So when I say supersonic, it is a aircraft that can fly greater than the speed of sound. So basically, a Concorde used to fly from London to New York in less than 2 hours. Two and a half hours. Whereas if you go in a regular commercial jetliner, it takes 8 hours to fly between London to New York. So it basically kind of takes 1/4 of the time to cross the Atlantic. So that was one of the reason why Concorde was a preferred aircraft, which was used by ultra rich people like movie stars, politicians, industrialists who used to use that road. But there was an unfortunate accident that happened in Paris 10 years ago that basically grounded the entire Concorde fleet, which was the first supersonic aircraft. But now there are a lot of companies that are coming back to bring this supersonic aviation back. So we will see more of those things in years to come. Space tourism will become a reality. I'm sure the people who are in the call today, somebody would have taken a tour to space in years to come, or because that's going to become a reality with all the reusable rockets and the technology going there. At least people might not go to travel to different, like a moon or a planetary. At least they would go to the upper atmosphere and they could come back, right, to space and back. So that will become a reality in years to come. So that will spawn off a lot of technology side industries. Interplanetary explosion will be the critical thing in the space exploration. A lot of space agency, be it NASA, ISRO in India, European Space Agency, all this, or even Japanese Space Agency, they call it as JAXA. So all these people will have a lot of funded research on interplanetary explosion. So that will also open up opportunities for aerospace engineers. The last three things are basically not related to aviation, but these are general technological advances that are happening. And this will have a significant impact in aviation industry. You would have heard about artificial intelligence, machine learning. So these are the technologies that will get embedded in aviation products. So people will have a lot of, will work with a lot of these technologies. On the manufacturing side, current manufacturing, what we have is basically subtractive manufacturing. When I say subtractive manufacturing, if I want to make a component, I have a block of metal and I chip off the metal and make a component, right? So that is not a very efficient way of doing it because, it has a lot of, it is not very fast and efficient ways of doing it. So a new technology that has come up in the last years is additive manufacturing. This is basically printing a metal part. So if I give you a diagram of a CAD model of the a metal part, you can basically put it in a printer and say print and you have the metal part in your hand. It's as simple as that. Of course, the technology is kind of evolving. There are challenges, but in next couple of years, all these things will have a significant impact in the industry. And most of the people who study aerospace or who get into the aerospace industry would rub their shoulders on one of these technologies. So these are something I thought I will give you a perspective. Yeah. I'm open to questions if there is anything.
Yeah, there are a few questions. So this first question, which I see is it like metal 3D printing? Yes, it is like metal 3D printing. Metal 3D printing, yes. Yeah. So the other question is, how is the business aspect to engineering? So this is Prakul's question. So I did not quite get it. So what is the business aspect to engineering?
Let me answer that question with what I understood. Engineering and business are closely tied out, right? You cannot, let us say there is a company A, there is a company B, and both the companies make a product. Let's not take about aircraft, any product, right? Both the people are having, in terms of reliability and technology, both the products are good. But one guy sells the product at 10% less, one guy sells the product at 10% more. Which one would you buy, right? You would buy something that is 10% less because it is doing the same job. It is, why should I pay more? So the way that brings the difference in cost between product A and product E is because of the efficiency of the business processes and the strategies. So business is totally tied with engineering. Engineering cannot work in isolation because ultimately the products that are built has to be sold in the market, right? So business is a critical part of it.
Okay. So there is another question related to how is flight testing done? Sir, this is a question. How are flights tested? Is it using a simulator first or direct real life testing?
Okay. You got it right. Simulators are extensively used as part of aircraft development and system development. But the simulators will give a level of assurance that what we are developing is safe. But the proof is in the pudding, right? I mean, you can do all the simulators, but ultimately you have to take the aircraft and fly it physically. So making sure that it meets all the requirements. So flight testing is an activity like, let us say we are building a new aircraft. So there is something called as a first flight. If you go to some of the YouTube links and say, first flight of Airbus A350, there will be a lot of videos here because we have to, as part of, there are a lot of regulatory agencies that certify the aircraft. In America, it's called as FAA, Federal Aviation Authority. In Europe, it is called as EASA, EASA. So in India, it is called as DGCA for civil aircraft, and for military aircraft, it's called as CEMILAT. And these are the institutes, these are the organizations that basically certify whether the flight that has been developed is safe for flight. So one of the critical things that the certification agency looks is you have to show the mission of the aircraft and do all the mission what they lay out. Think of it as like they would give a list of flights that has to be performed, and you have to perform that flights and show that the aircraft is safe for operation.
Okay.
So that's a long, like in commercial aircraft, this flight testing activity can usually goes for at least 1 year or so, with flights almost every other day.
They have to show whether. Yeah, just to add here, for that matter, you know, who asked this question, I think this is Amog. So for any product, it is done the same way. So whether it is a car or a aircraft, or even for that matter, a potato chip which you eat, first we try to kind of simulate. Yes, obviously cost implications would be there. So if it is easy to replicate the product, you know, at a cost effective manner, you'll do that. But if it is quite huge, for example, in case of aircraft, you can't really have a destructive testing on a built aircraft because that will take away a lot of money from your pocket. So hence simulators become, and hence what Sir was talking about, the software side of it, aerospace mixed with software together can help save a lot of money. Why? Because you don't need to test every time you create a test on a real product. Rather, you simulate, see what are errors and scope of improvement. You do that. Once you are doubly sure that, okay, in the simulator, it is working fine, then you go to a real world testing. So that saves a lot of...
Basically, to add to Tushar, what I would say is, simulator gives you a confidence to go on the real equipment, right? See, without simulator, if you go on to the real physical equipment, it is like shooting in the dark, right? If you do everything on the simulator, you know, these are the parameters that the system has to come.
Yeah.
So you basically, it basically assures you to do the testing. But there is nothing like real testing. Nothing can replace the real testing. But it just ensures that you're not having any design flaws, obvious design flaws. And basically, if you do everything in simulation and go on to the physical test, the chances of success is very, very high. That's one of the... And another thing is the cost aspects. You don't have to test all the universe of points, right?
Yes.
You want to test only that is critical, that you want to show and prove to the agency's certification.
So the next... there's another question which was previously asked, by we missed it actually. And it is related to, I think, some social issues. So the question is, isn't there the issue of space potentially being commercialized if private players take a major part in space projects? So there is something called, we are really concerned about something called space debris, sir. So lots of satellites are going up in space, and they are exponentially growing.
Yes.
Now there's another issue which is very much now important, is that the debris which is there, and it poses a huge risk to human life as well as further aviation. So how are we going to tackle that?
So I would look my personal view, I would look at problems as opportunity, right? Tushar, you said about space debris. Yeah, there are a lot of space debris today, but it is not at a level where it is hampering the satellites or flight. But let us say it is colliding with the satellites and hampering the space flight. It will lead to some other innovation, a new industry, right?
Okay.
There will be industry that you can design lasers.
Docking and all that will happen.
To clean, it's like a device that can clean the garbage in the space, right? So that's a new industry.
So this is a good way of looking at it. Though.
Yeah,
so
I mean,
a, yeah, yeah.
Everything is linked with each other, right?
Yes.
I mean, today we have industries because there is a problem that needs to be solved.
Yeah.
If there is no problem, there is no industry required. Aerospace industry is there because it wants to solve the problem of mobility. People want to go from... one continent to another in a couple of hours. They don't want to take 30 days to go on a boat ride.
Mm-hmm.
So problems basically give rise to industry. And industry basically give rise to commerce. And of course, that's how all the subjects and
follow-up question is Monisha, what is she's asking is not space debris. My problem wasn't that. I was worried about how space will be used less as a research point for passionate people and more as a marketing outlet, advertising done through space hotels, brands which get their names on that space hotel placed on a high pedestal while putting research on a lower priority. That's what she's asking. So this is
That's the world. I mean, anytime commercialization comes, it's a market. And until now, it's like a market that was not open to everybody. The moment the market opens up, yes, there will be commercial.
These aspects are going to be there. Yes.
Yes, aspects are going to be there. There is nothing that we can do about it.
So another question from Harsh Raj is, so what were the safety issues that led to the decommissioning of Concord?
I'll talk about that. So there was a flight from Paris to, I think, New York that was landing in Paris airport, Charles de Gaulle airport. Just before they landed in the airport, they had an explosion in one of the tires of the Concorde, and that unfortunately kind of ruptured the fuel tanks, and the entire aircraft, the Concorde, lost. I mean, it just exploded. If you go and see in YouTube, you can see that very unfortunate incident. Before that also, there was a lot of problems in Concorde, and the main issues with Concorde was on the tires because of the supersonic speed, and there are a lot of issues on that, and they used to change the tires as often as possible.
Okay.
That was one of the big problems. So only two airlines used to operate Concorde, British Airways and Air France. So because Concorde was a joint development of Britain and France. So Concorde was costing more to maintain than operate, right? The money you get from selling the tickets were far less than the amount of maintenance that needs to be done. For safety aspects, they used to change their tires very often. So ultimately, in everything, economics take up a seat, right?
Yeah.
Both British Airways and Air France were looking at a time to decommission this aircraft because it was costing more than what it was required to operate. Yeah. So they were, they were in this two minds, but whenever this accident happened, that kind of hastened the process of Concorde retirement. So this brings a very important point. Whatever systems or products we develop, it has to be economically feasible. Otherwise, there's no point of developing all these things, right?
Mm.
So great engineering will survive only if it is economically sound and economically powerful. Otherwise, it cannot survive. So that is something all engineers have to keep in back of their mind. It is not just the novelty of technology that will sell. It is how you can solve the problem at the lowest cost. So that's the winner.
Sure. So, sir, we'll just, quickly, I'm jotting down the questions we'll take up once we are done. Yeah. So there are a few more slides to be covered. So So all those who have put the questions, don't worry. I have recorded it. We will be discussing it. Yeah.
Okay. Now I have a very interesting activity. I just want all of you to, I request a few minutes of concentration here. I'll just play a video. Just see, 2030 would look something like this. Just see a salient points. We'll discuss about this. I will just share this video.
Sound,
Before that, I will get into the computer. Sound mode. Okay. Tushar, let me know if my video is coming loud and clear. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I have done all the optimization. Let me play the video. And please watch this video and we'll discuss about this. Thank you. Okay. Did you see this video? Can you type in the chat box, what was the thing that was really glaring in this? What is one observation you saw in this? Somebody, Prakul says, is it all possible in 9 years? Yes, 100%.
No pollution, no traffic.
Excellent. That's an excellent point. No pollution because that's an electric aircraft. No traffic in a city like Bangalore. If you are flying between one part of city to another part of city, you don't have to worry about the traffic jams and your car getting stuck. So this is reality, guys. In at least 9 years from now, a lot of these type of vehicles will start appearing in our airspace. And these type of air vehicles don't require expensive airports or anything. Tall buildings, they have aircraft landing pads. And if you see in the beginning what that lady did, so she took a Uber app. She wanted to go from one part of the city to another part. She just pressed her destination. And the Uber app basically kind of calculated which is the optimal way to go for it. So a part of her journey was taken with that aircraft, urban air mobility aircraft. And a part of the traffic, part of her journey, she made with a physical Uber car. So this is the power of technology that we are talking about that is going to come to the aerospace industry. When I spoke about saying that much of the aerospace will move from being a very tightly controlled to a more democratic thing, this is what I was talking about. And this is a big reality. And there are a lot of companies who are developing on this kind of thing. And there's a lot of technologies that are there in this. First of all, it's electric aircraft. And in a couple of years from now, this particular aircraft will not have any pilot. It's autonomous, just like we have heard about autonomous cars, right? Driverless cars. This particular aircraft would not have a pilot. It's just driven by software in autonomous way. So what are all the technologies I spoke about in the prior chart? You will see a lot of these things coming up in the years to come. So this is one thing I wanted to show you, how the future looks like for aviation.
There is a question now about the cost aspect of it. Yes, indeed, it is costly. It will be costly. And there is a question related to how can, you know, only the rich can afford it. And so I'm just summarizing whatever
I will. Let me put my perspective. Yeah. Cost is driven by how much of people use it, right? 30 years ago in India, how many people had cars, right? Very, very few people had cars. But fast forward 30 years now, everybody has a car. So when the mass production happens, technology will become affordable to everybody. Today, it looks like it's very expensive, but as the days go by, I mean, take about simple things. Most of you might not know how much expensive was a computer. Today, everybody has a computer in a pocket. I mean, the smartphone is nothing but a very powerful computer. But when I was studying, to go to a computer, to get access to computer, you had to go into a room that had computers, and this was an air-conditioned room. And you had to literally struggle to get half an hour of your time to do programming. Got it, right? So computers were so much as a novelty or a experience, novelty item. But now even the poorest man in the street also has a smartphone, which is nothing but a computer. So once the technology gets rolling, right, affordability will come down.
And the most important part is that this is why we are doing this session. You guys are going to join this workforce to make it cheaper. So that's the intent. So hence, you know, if it is costly, then you have to break your head into how to make it cheaper and affordable to the common masses. So that's what the intent is. So we see, just because something is costly, so hence we should stop it and not do anything about it. It's not the answer.
Yes.
What we need to do is, okay, this is an opportunity, there's a challenge, and hence, you know, so, you know, not every question in CentaMars is solvable, you can't do that, so hence, but that gives you a what do you say, a kick to kind of get it into affordable domain. So that's what the intent is. So we know that this is possible. 100 years back, internet was not possible. It was a fiction. Today it is cheaper, and today Aadhaar card and what is that? All Jam Trinity and all those people are using phone pay, Google Pay. These were technologies which were unimaginable some 50 years back, but today it is affordable, right? So that's where technology enables. It's an enabler.
Yes.
And that's why you guys will be joining that workforce, which is expected to make it affordable to the common man. So that's my answer.
Rightly said, Tushar. Technology is an enabler for the future, right? So engineers, generation of engineers will build upon what the previous generation of engineers built in, right? So all of you will be the next generation of engineers who will work on this. And you are sitting on the shoulder of giants, right? So that's how the human progress happens, because the every generation tries to improve better than what the previous generation is. And that is progress, right?
Yeah.
Any other questions before we move on to the next chat?
There was a question related to AI asked by Kinshuk. I think that question was related to how AI will be deployed in...
Okay, yeah. That's a very... AI will encompass everything in aviation. The simplest thing is, I talked about autonomous... this particular vehicle, what we saw in the video, this might be pilotless. It has to drive by itself. So the software that is helping this vehicle to fly would have some kind of AI, and it is built with a lot of artificial intelligence in it, right? So it may have sensors wherein, as this, remember, these aircraft will not be flying in clear blue skies at a very high altitude. These are hopping from one building to another building, right? So it has to prevent collisions with aircrafts like this coming in opposite direction and the buildings. So there will be sensors, advanced sensors in this aircraft. And all these sensors will give input. And there is a very intelligent software that is running, basically making the autonomous flight possible. So that is one of the example how artificial intelligence...
And many other things. There will be lots of safety angles, which has to be taken care of. So let's say if the flight runs into a trouble, then what are the exit options and things like that? So there will be multiple... such deployments, right? And then route selection. And today also, if you see...
Yeah, route selection. That's very nice point, but sir. See, you saw that lady, she wanted to go from one point to another point. She opened up an app and she kind of keyed in. But how did the app decide a part of her journey has to be by flight and part of the journey has to be by car, right? So probably that app calculated the time it takes to go by car on a city traffic congestion versus the aircraft. So all these things are intelligence that is built in the app. So artificial intelligence is also there in that app, whatever they are built in.
Yeah. Perfect. And not only in the application side, what I understand is, let's say in the development side also, lots of AI is deployed to improve functionalities or make it most cost effective and things like that. So there again, on the development side also, there will be a lot of application of AI.
Yes.
Yeah.
Any more questions or should we go?
Yeah, we can go ahead, sir. I think, we can. Yeah.
No, already.
So this is a chart I put it. Today, if you gaze the sky looks different. Let's say fast forward to 2030, if you look up to the skies would have some kind of vehicles like this. This is not science fiction, guys. This is real thing. In fact, these aircrafts, whatever it is flying, this is not some work of art. These are actual aircrafts that are currently being built and they are testing the aircraft. This particular aircraft is called as a Volocopter. This has been deployed in Singapore to kind of use between the between
corporate buildings, I believe.
Corporate buildings in the city without going through the using the road. So these are not... this is not science fiction. This is a real thing. And there is a big advantage using vehicles like this. Let us say we want to connect remote parts of the country. The only option today we have is to lay the roads to connect remote parts of the country, right? The problem with laying roads is it's prohibitively expensive. You have to cut the trees. There is ecological impact for all these things. So a nicer solution of this is having a small vehicles like this, so that you can connect all the remote parts of the country. And if there is no airport, you could possibly design a structure like this, which is more like a water tank kind of thing, what we see, right? So this can serve as a safe landing point for this kind of vehicles. And this doesn't have much of an ecological impact of cutting down the trees or taking a very expensive way of laying the roads. And at the same time, every part of the country is connected. So this will be a big game changer in the years to come. We are not talking about aircraft that is going into space or very high altitude aircraft like what we are seeing in commercial aircraft. These aircrafts will not fly at very altitude. It is going to fly at a lower altitude, just trying to cover small distances within the cities. It's not this type of aircrafts are not going to fly from, let us say, Bangalore to New York or Bangalore to London. This kind of transportation system will be within the city. Like if you want to move from one part of the Bangalore to another part, or if you want to
go for a fest in some other school, they will take it from NPS Rajachinagar to Indranagar.
Exactly. Yeah, I think so. This will be a big area which will drive lots of innovation in years to come. Okay, I think with this we have kind of come to a point wherein we covered a lot of ground on aerospace. I gave you a overview about what aerospace engineering is, what are the institutes, what are the opportunities, how does the future look for aerospace. So I kind of put this chart to basically this slide is more for you to think about. I mean, this is not a guidance or this is not a advice what I'm giving, but I just put this thought: if somebody is passionate about aerospace, what are the key things that he or she should be doing, or he or she should be concentrating on? Needless to say, a clear understanding of physics and mathematics concepts are a key for aerospace engineering. All the math and physics what you study in class 8 until class 12, this is the same thing that will be used throughout. In fact, Tushar would agree with me, even in engineering you don't study anything new. It's all the same thing what you learn now. The clarity of concepts what you develop in 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 will give a good foundation for you as you get into the university. So mathematics and physics are really important. When I say really important, I mean getting a clarity of everything that is being taught, and having the clarity and able to think through in that clarity is a key thing. Next point I would like to talk about is curiosity. I mean, this is very important. Curiosity comes from a point wherein we have to question everything. Like for example, I really like somebody asking the question, would this be expensive? Yeah, it's a very valid question. But a curious mind would say, okay, it is expensive. What all it takes to make this affordable to everybody? So that's where the innovation comes. That's where the new products come. So being curious is a very, very important thing. I know in this Zoom session, we have students from 9th, 10th.
11th, 12th.
So one thing I personally feel one of the skills all of us should pick up is our ability to learn to code, irrespective of whichever branch of engineering or medicine, whatever we do. Because coding is a very, very key skill that is required for any field. And needless to say, aerospace engineering also. Don't get really bogged down with the language or anything. You do whatever is convenient for you or whatever is it. But develop a very, very strong understanding and ability to code, because the next set of years that are going to come, software is everywhere. Even today as we talk, right, software is in everything. If you go and see a car, whether you know it or not, there are millions of lines of code in the car, because all the complex function that is there in today's cars are done by software. So if you go and look around all the devices around your house, you can see that every device, any smart device, like for example, you know, Alexa, right? Alexa, the smart speaker, you know how much of software is there inside that. So software brings new capabilities, advanced capabilities, and newer capabilities into any system. So learning to code is a very, very important skill. So I would say that learn to code not as a curriculum or anything, as a hobby. Try to build, work on projects, understand coding. So this is going to be very, very important in the next set of years as you get into the university and ultimately to the workforce. Another point I thought I will stress here is today's world, in today's world, the success is for people who demonstrate a lot of creativity and who take up real world problems and solve the problems. So one way to enhance creativity is to use our hands to build something. So that is one skill we have. I feel that in today's world where everything has become a smartphone or everything has become virtual, that is something that we are really losing it. So one of the good ways to do it is to build devices by yourself. Like I would like to, I don't know how many of you know Arduino. I would strongly encourage so people who are really interested to build things to explore Arduino. This is a very, very low cost, easily accessible system wherein you can build a lot of systems using this. Mm-hmm. And it is a totally, I would say like a modular thing. You can, let us say you want to build a simple example like a collision avoidance system. By spending around 900 rupees, you can build it in Arduino. Arduino is the hardware. The key thing is software, which is all available as a Arduino community. Integrating hardware, software, and the community, you could build a lot of devices and intelligent devices. And I say this because in the next coming years, we have to find solutions for the tough problems what we have. And tough problems are solved only by creativity. And creativity is ability to do things by our hand. So that is very, very important. And last but not least, whichever area you study, whatever you study, always have fun. Don't do it because you have to do it, and don't push yourself. Look at, there is beauty in everything. In fact, all the things what I spoke today, none of this is my knowledge. These are all the generation of engineers and scientists who have worked before all of us, and they have put the knowledge in our hands. So it is our responsibility to use this knowledge and advance this knowledge and hand over to the next generation. So wow, with this, wow. I will stop my presentation. So I am open for Q&A.
Great, great. Thanks for that enlightening wrap-up, sir. And I would just like to enhance upon or, you know, just talk about this problem-solving part of it. And, you know, I have been observing that unlike what we used to, you know, go through, the current, you know, set of students, they are also very passionate about problem solving. But one thing which I have noticed is that instant gratification part of getting the solution faster. Now, my take of all this, what sir was also saying, you know, we cannot be desperate for solutions. You have to think and, you know, emphasize more on the thought process and innovating on the solution rather than just searching on the Google and find the solution and be satisfied that I know this problem now. That's not the intent of problem solving. The intent of problem solving is to make sure that you have the right thought process to solve the problem and not fetch the solution somehow. That's point number one. Do not get disheartened when you're not able to solve the problem. That's another, you know, observation which I am seeing. See, you guys are real fortunate that you have Google and Alexas and the series of the world. And I know tomorrow there will be an assistant sitting in next to your table and you have a problem and you dictate it to this particular device and it gives you the solution. But that's not the fun part of it. So, you know, if we remember for one question of physics or math, we used to spend hours together and we used to enjoy that. There will be frustration, no doubt about it. There will be frustration, but that frustration itself gives you joy when you're able to solve this finally. So don't lose heart when you're not able to solve problems. I see that, you know, the face going, you know, the language of the face changing and all the moment you are getting, you know, stuck in problem solving. Develop the thought process, enjoy problem solving, enjoy not being able to solve also. And, you know, that is a huge learning in itself. So that will be my advice. And with those, and if there is any question, maybe, you know, So there's lots of discussion now, sir. You have basically, you know, opened the Pandora's box. There's lots of discussion about Arduino versus Raspberry Pi and all those. So, you know, those who want, you know, some projects on that, you can touch base with me. I'll give you 2 books for free, but you have to come to me. I will not give it to you. So there are lots of projects if you really want to build on that. And, you know, both are good. I have tested both. And, you know, obviously there will be a different level of understanding needed. Arduino, I found it easier to go about because the community is also very enriched. And, you know, the components are very low cost. Vis-a-vis, let's say, components of the other processors and all. So what sir is suggesting, not to hook onto one particular processor or a board, it's basically, it can be clay modeling also. It can be, you know, designing kites maybe, you never know. Everything, what the emphasis is on doing it with your own hands, right? Rather than, you know, so that's what the thing is. You can be an artist, you can be, you know, music developer, what, I don't know. So anything creative is good. So that's where you need to think, you need to spend time. And, you know, that's something which comes out of you. And that's what the emphasis is. Not a particular board as such. You can do that. That's very easy. And, you know, lots of resources are available. So hence we are suggesting that. But that was the takeaway, I believe. That is what is my understanding. Yeah. So, okay. So now I think most of the questions are taken and we are also running out of time. So I will conclude the session. I think liked what sir told about us, and he took out, you know, time from his schedule and came and talked about the engineering aspect and very beautifully structured. So I would like to thank on the behalf of Centum Academy, sir, and students, those who are there can also, you know, just share some words of appreciation for sir. And that will be, you know, real gratitude towards him. So for all of that, you know, with those words, I will now conclude the session. I hope everybody is safe and stay safe, all of you. If anything related to aerospace you want to know more about engineering colleges or how to get into all of that, you can always touch base with us. And if there is a domain specific thing you want to ask, let us know. We will forward the query to sir and the response back to you. That's how we will be doing it. With those words, I really wish and hope that everybody is safe and secure. Thanks a lot, sir, for having spared time.
Thanks, Tushar, for this opportunity. I really, I didn't know how did I spend this 1.5 hours interacting with a lot of young minds.
So I am very hopeful, sir. These people are going to devise those copters, whatever we talked about, and I'm going to sit on that. So my only vested interest to do all of this is, come 10, 15 years down the line, I'll be able to avail those technologies on because of these fine people. So that's the
thing. I'm really happy that I got opportunity to interact with the future generation of engineers, doctors, scientists in this forum. I would like to thank Centum Academy for giving me this opportunity.
Pleasure, sir. It's all our pleasure.
Thank you, Tushar, for enabling this. And thanks all the participants today. You have been really, you have given your Saturday to listen to me. So enjoy the rest of your weekend and thank you very much.
Thanks, sir. Thanks. Good night.